Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, we beseech thee, grant thy people grace to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow thee, the only God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, art one God, world without end.
Amen.
The epistle is written in the first chapter of the first epistle of Blessed Paul the Apostle to the Corinthians, beginning at the fourth verse. Brethren, I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything ye are enriched by him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here endeth the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
I was glad when they said unto me, we will go into the house of the Lord. Peace be within thy walls, and plenteousness within thy palaces. Alleluia, alleluia. The heathen shall fear thy name, O Lord, and all the kings of the earth thy majesty. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The Holy Gospel is written in the 22nd chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew, beginning at the 34th verse.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
At that time, when the Pharisees had heard that Jesus had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. And then one of them, who was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he? They say unto him, The son of David. He saith unto them, How then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand, till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? And no man was able to answer him a word, neither durst any man from that day forth ask him any more questions. Praise be to thee, O Christ. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father, all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who, for us men and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost, the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
When you think about what we are called to do and how we are called to live by the hand of God through the person of Jesus, what is our Christian calling? Well, first of all, if we use just the propers for the day, we have some very good insight given to us. First, we are called to resist the many and the varied temptations thrown at us by the world, the flesh, and the devil. We hear that in today's collect or prayer. And then secondly, you and I are called to grow in knowledge and love of God. That's also in the collect, isn't it? By both word and deed, so that, as Paul puts it in today's epistle, we may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the last day. Now that's our walk with and toward Christ in this life. But first we have to deal with this thing called temptation. You know, there are some folk that think that they can get rid of temptation altogether, you know, but they can't really. The only way you can get rid of temptation is to succumb to it and becomes a lifestyle instead of a temptation, right? It's always there. This temptation is always there for us as Christians, as God's people. It's always there. It's a part of life in this world and has a tremendous draw on us. It never stops. It keeps trying to topple us over. It's always there. And one person put it this way. He said, those who flee temptation generally leave a forwarding address. Now that means that, you know, temptation always knows where we are in the physical sense and also in the spiritual sense, right? But we have the ability to resist it. And that's what the collect tells us. We can say no to temptation, no matter what form it may take in our life. The world may entice, the flesh may attract, the devil may coax, but none of that matters because we have been given God's grace. Remember Paul's reminder to us, there has no temptation taken you, but such as is common to all people, all man. And God is faithful. He will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but with the temptation he will make a way for you to escape, that you may be able to bear it. That's powerful, and we know that to be true. You know, a while back, do you remember someone said it in a very different way? But it was the same truth. A lot of kind of unchurched people heard this utterance. This person said, when the Lord closes the door, somewhere he opens a window. You know where that came from? The Sound of Music. Thank you, Maria von Trapp. That's a powerful truth of life. And so the old excuse, the devil made me do it, and we hear that at times, is balderdash. It's poppycock. He can't make us do anything. Old Scratch can't make us do anything, most assuredly. He may serve up a temptation, your temptation, on a silver platter, but it's you and me who take the first bite, isn't it? So we enact it ourselves. And so we learn to resist temptation. That's one of the things we have to do in our calling by Christ. Then what are we going to do with all that extra time if we're not sinning? Well, we are freed up then to do good and godly things, because if we don't do good, we'll fall back into that slimy pit of sin that we had in the first place. Now, to see how to do good, it's easy. It's an easy thing to identify. We look to Jesus. And we see that each time he was tempted, his response shows us what to do. It was not only to say no to the temptation, but to respond with goodness. In short, he always did good, godly, holy, heavenly things focused on his Father. And by doing so, he shows us that it is not enough merely to say no. We must act out our beliefs both in word and deed in our life. And so the Christian faith really is not simply a highly defined system of thou shalt nots. To see it as such is to admit one's limited understanding of Christ, of his life, and of his teachings. Jesus enables us to grow into wholeness and holiness and sanctity. He never inhibits any of us, nor restricts the growth of anyone who follows him. He always makes us more full by his presence and love. But there are some things which we as his followers are called to reject. And that's the problem with many a modern in our own day and age. And actually it's been this way through every generation, really. To know the difference between that which brings fullness and happiness as opposed to that which brings emptiness and despair. So what delivers us? What protects us? It's simple. God's grace and his love. And living the life he offers us through Christ. And the place to not only start but to end is found in the gospel narrative for today, in this encounter between Jesus and the lawyer. It's the key to it all, right there. He says, what is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus responded, love God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. We call it the summary of the law. We say it every time we have Mass here. But it's a love that comes from God, not the schmaltzy, the vacuous, fleeting feeling that you and I as fallen human beings perpetuate or experience so often one to another. You know, the kind that hurts the heart of many people so badly that some of them are, after that terrible experience, afraid to step out in love again. This past week, I read a writing of a man who graduated from Manhattan School of Music. He lives in New York City. He's a professional musician. And he said, I want to write a sequel to the song, You're Getting to Be a Habit with Me. You know the song? Frank Sinatra sang it, and a lot of other people did too. I want to write a sequel to that song. He said, it would be about a scorned man, post-relationship, who realizes that all of the romantic ideals explored in the original song were falsified and a complete sham. A man lured by a siren, suffering a complete collapse. And then he ends by saying, if this song were written, it would provide me a sense of realistic closure from the delusions of the first. That's how we love far too often in the world. An empty shell and an articulation of the word, but no deeds, no action, no heart. There is an old blues song that says it about all of this part of our human condition, about that tendency to use rather than love people. The lyrics say it all. It says, nobody loves me but my mother, and she could be jiving me too. Well, it need not be like that. God shows us how to love. It's the love of the cross. It's agape, unconditional love. When that is the bedrock of one's life, temptations are put into perspective and become but the fire, the tempering of a person in the process of becoming God's saints. You don't get rid of temptation, but you become, by God's grace and love, stronger because you made it through and still stand in the light of Christ Jesus. We have His grace. We have His love. And it will carry us in the end straight into the eternal, everlasting presence of God Himself.